This is Research Like a Pro, episode 153, U.S. Non-Population Schedules. Welcome to Research Like a Pro, a genealogy podcast about taking your research to the next level, hosted by Nicole Dyer and Diana Elder, accredited genealogy professional. Diana and Nicole are the mother-daughter team at FamilyLocket.com and the creators of the Amazon best-selling book, Research Like a Pro, a Genealogist's Guide. I'm Nicole, co-host of the podcast. Join Diana and me as we discuss how to stay organized, make progress in our research, and solve difficult cases. Let's go. Welcome to Research Like a Pro.
Hi, Nicole. How are you today?
I'm doing well. I am really excited to work on some DNA analysis because I just got access to a DNA test from one of our cousins who's a generation closer to my research subject. So it's really kind of exciting to look at his matches and see if they provide any more evidence for this question that I'm working on. So it's great to have somebody in grandpa's generation because he passed away before we could get him tested.
And even better that you know specifically where this individual's line lies. That line, we don't have quite as many matches. So this will be really good to have this DNA.
Yes, he had tested at MyHeritage and then couldn't figure out how to share any information from that test with me. And so I just sent him and his son a new test for Ancestry. And so now I have him in another database, which is really helpful because there's a lot more people and matches in Ancestry's database. So that's been wonderful. And it's been really nice to work with his son who can, you know, do all the tech side and log in and share the results with me. I'm really grateful that I was able to find this man's son to help me with that.
Yes, and a plus for me was that the son was an artist and you commissioned a painting of my grandmother for me. It was my grandmother, Eddie Bell. She passed away before I was born. And now I have this wonderful painting that he did, taken from three photographs of her in her younger years. So that was kind of a fun plus connection of that.
Yes, it was. And it was fun to connect with him on Facebook and talk about genealogy with him. I always feel like I'm asking a lot when I ask someone to help me with taking a DNA test and doing all of this. So it was nice to be able to support his painting as like a thank you, but also to receive an amazing painting was worth it.
It was a win-win all the way around, that's for sure.
So what have you been working on or reading?
Well, I'm almost through my book by Brooks Blevins, A History of the Ozarks, and this was volume one. And I've talked about it on the podcast before, and I've enjoyed it so much. And this very last section of it is all about religion and seeing the different churches and the denominations come into the area, northern Arkansas and southern Missouri. He talks all about the Methodists and the Baptists and the Presbyterians. It's just been fascinating. And I love how he uses firsthand accounts, you know, people that left behind diaries or journals or letters to really bring it to life. It's been a really good book. So I would highly recommend it if anyone has got some ancestral ties to those areas. You'll just learn so much about the background of the Ozarks. And he's got a volume number two, which goes into the Civil War time. So I think I'm probably going to have to order that one too, because I know there's more that I need to learn. And we have so many family lines that come out of that area. They didn't stay there per se, but they passed through on their way to Texas. And it's really opened my eyes to what their lives were like. So I highly recommend that book.
That's neat. Do you think we're related to Brooks Blevins because of our Blevins connection?
Very possible. Because the Blevins were a family there in that area. So I know there were a lot of them, though.
Didn't Eliza Eisenhower's sister, Texanna, marry a Blevins?
Yeah, there's a lot of intermarriage with the Blevinses and the Schultz lines and the Eisenhowers. So we have a lot of Blevins that come in and out of the family history there in Arkansas and Texas. They're all connected somehow. Mm-hmm. And I know when we were doing the research, it was confusing because of so many connections. So now that we know more of what we're doing and we have better methods to track people, I think we could revisit some of those things and really figure it out a little bit better.
Yeah.
Well, let's do our announcements and then we can get to our topic of the day. We have got registration open right now for our Research Like a Pro DNA Study group, which begins in September. We are also taking applications for our peer group leaders. So if you're interested in learning more about that, you can go to Family Locket and look at the DNA study group and learn about requirements, prerequisites, the schedule, all the fun things that you are wondering about. And be sure to join the study group email list, because that will let you get advance notice of our early bird registration. And then also you'll want to join our regular Family Locket newsletter, where we put our deals. Anyway, we hope to work with many of you this fall in the DNA study group.
Yeah, that will be fun. Well, today we have Alice Childs here again. Welcome, Alice.
Thank you. It's good to be back.
Alice is one of our researchers, and she's also been a peer group leader in past study groups. So we're really glad to have her with us, and she's a really fun friend. You know, Alice and I got to know each other for the first time at Roots Tech, and she's a really wonderful researcher. It's fun to talk to her. So I'm glad that she's here today to talk with us about the non-population schedules from the U.S. Federal Census collection. So Alice, tell us a little bit about this record group and kind of why it might be helpful.
Okay, so I think everyone's familiar with population schedules. I know when I first started researching, I didn't know that there were different schedules, and I would see this word population schedule, you know, in citations, and I thought, what? Why do we put that in there? And then I started studying and learned that there's a whole other set of census schedules called non-population schedules. They can play a huge role in helping us learn more about our ancestors. They each covered the year preceding the taking of the census. So if the census was enumerated on June 1st of 1850 or whatever, then that non-population schedule covers the entire year prior. So there are several different kinds of non-population schedules, and we'll just be talking about each one and giving examples of how we can use them in our research.
Yeah, that will be helpful, because there are some different types, and I think it'll be good to go over them and really talk about why we might want to use them. Because I think a lot of the time we just focus on the population schedules, looking for people's residents and their family members. So it'll be fun to dive into how we can learn more about the geographic and historical context, the social context of their lives, and what it can tell us about them.
Right. I think we tend to forget the non-population schedules and what we can find out from them in our hurry to use the population schedules and find our ancestor. So I'm excited to review and really think outside the box a little bit with our research. So let's start with the agricultural schedules. And I know these are the ones that I've used the most, because my ancestors were pretty much all farmers. So can you tell us a little bit more about those?
Yeah, agricultural schedules were taken in 1850, 60, 70, and 80. So these are basically lists of farm owners, and they provide details about their farms. So one thing you need to remember, even if your ancestor was a farmer, they might not have been included if their farm was very small. I think I saw something like less than $300 on one of the censuses. You know, the instructions in the censuses will tell you which farms were included on the schedules. But they provide information that gives the name of the farm owner, and then also information about their acreage and livestock and what kind of goods they produce and the cash value of the farm. So it's important to think about how this might be able to help you. So on a regular population schedule, it might just say farmer for an occupation. But when you find your ancestor on the agricultural schedule, you can just see a better picture of what their day-to-day life might have been like. On one census that I was looking at, on one agricultural schedule, I noticed one farmer had 40 acres of improved land and one had just 8 acres of improved land. And it was just interesting to note how the larger farm had a lot more animals and cash flow, and the smaller one, of course, had less production. And so it's just gives you a little bit more context so you can understand how well off your ancestor might have been, what kind of things they might have been working on, what crops they grew, that sort of thing.
Oh, I totally agree. I know I was looking at my Thomas B. Royston in Chambers County, Alabama, either 1850 or 1860, and I knew he probably grew cotton. His probate had 2 cotton gins, so I knew he had cotton, but I was really surprised to see the variety of crops, you know, things like sweet potatoes and barley and wheat. A lot of different types of things. And then the other ancestors that I've used this for are some of the ones out in Texas. And I was able to trace them through at least two, if not three, agricultural censuses and see how they improved the land. And it was so interesting because they were maybe given 160 acres. I can't remember for sure, but they had only improved at first like 5 acres. And the rest of it was just all grazing land. I'm sure, you know, there wasn't water. But then the next year they had done a little bit more improvement. And so it was fun to see how they worked with the land. So many things that we can look at and learn through these agricultural censuses.
Yes, that's a really good example. You know, when Alice was talking about how some farms were not included if they were not large enough, I remembered the instructions for the agricultural census talked about this, and I was just looking at that again. So I thought I would read this part. There's a couple things that are interesting here. So in the explanation of Schedule 4 agriculture for 1850, it talks about how the enumerators should not record people who have small lots that are following different pursuits other than farming, where they have some plants growing, you know, like maybe just a garden, where the production is not $100 in value. So basically, if the farm doesn't produce more than $100 worth of goods, then it wasn't included in the 1850 agricultural census. And then for 1870, dropping down a bit, they had a little change there too. They made it even higher. Plus 20 years had gone by, so probably inflation played a role. But no farm will be reported of less than 3 acres unless $500 worth of produce has been actually sold off from it during the year. It's so interesting, you know, to think about who was listed.
Yeah, I think that's really important. I think the key to these schedules is to read the instructions so you know. Even if your ancestor was a farmer, this might be why he wasn't included.
And it is kind of sad to think of somebody who's just growing barely enough food to survive, like a subsistence farm or something. But I think a lot of people were in that boat. What is our next type of census? Tell us about manufacturing schedules.
Manufacturing schedules give us details about manufacturing operations. And again, it has a limit of $500. It's companies that produced goods greater than $500 in the year prior to the census. And these were created in 1820 and then again in 1850 through 1880. And they include a lot of information about the business, including the type of business, how many employees they had, raw materials used, the value of goods produced. And even if your ancestor didn't own one of the industries that are listed, I think they're really valuable because it can help you have a better idea of what jobs were available in the area and what life might have been like for your ancestor. I did a research project a couple years ago about some immigrants who came to Cohos in Albany County, New York, and they were working in garment factories. And so on one of the manufacturing schedules, it talks about lots of garment manufacturing companies in that area. And so one of them was a Bailey manufacturing company. And it talked about they used 150,000 pounds of cotton, and 45,000 pounds of wool, some dye materials and fuel, and made thousands of shirts and drawers. And their total value was $95,000. So this looks like it was a pretty well-run business that made a lot of money. And they had 40 male laborers, and the males earned an average of $25 per month. And they had 100 female laborers that they employed, and they earned an average of $7 per month. So I think these are interesting statistics that can help you see what life was like. You know, if you were a woman trying to make a living for a family, that might have been hard on $7 per month as compared to $25 per month that the males were earning. So it just gives us a better idea of what our ancestors' lives were like.
Wow, that's quite a discrepancy in pay for males versus females. Oh my goodness. That's a really interesting example to think about. You know, I hadn't thought about going into the town and looking at their main type of manufacturing, but that really does give some historical context to the economy of the place and understanding, you know, what they were producing, what kind of jobs were available, and what the typical pay might be. So good example.
Thanks. They're pretty fascinating.
I think that is something that we really don't think about doing very much, is checking out these manufacturing schedules. And I decided to look up one for fun in Columbus, Georgia, which is one of my research locations. And they have a flour mill, which I think we probably would find in just about every area because, you know, you had to grind that wheat into flour, and that was one of the very first types of manufacturing. Often it was very crude manufacturing, just on water wheels, you know, wherever there was a stream, and people would come from all over to grind their wheat into flour. But as you look at these big cities, you can really get a feel for what people were doing. So, oh, fun. Thanks for talking us through that one a little bit. Another schedule is the mortality schedules. And I think probably a lot of our listeners have used those a bit because we're always trying to figure out when people died. So tell us a little bit more about those.
I love the mortality schedules just because they do give us some details that we might miss in other censuses. They're available for 1850 to 1880 and then again in 1885. And because vital records didn't begin until much later in most states, this might be the only place that lists a person's death, and it can be a great substitute for vital records. They include a person's name, their age, their sex, marital status, their state or country of birth, their month of death, their occupation, cause of death, and length of final illness. So there are a lot of great details included. So if your ancestor died in the year prior to a census enumeration, it's a really good idea to go and look for them on the mortality schedules. One other thing that I really like about these mortality schedules is that if there's a child that was born in that year before the census, they would not appear on the census. If they died prior to the census being taken, they would appear on the mortality schedule, which that could be the only record you would have of a child that was born during that year. So I think it's really valuable for that too.
The other way I have used those mortality schedules is just to see what people were dying of, because they'll list the cause of death, and you can see if there were a lot of people dying from yellow fever or from cholera. You could see like when an epidemic maybe swept through, and whether your ancestor is listed or not, it could explain some people who had died in the family, and maybe they didn't die to be listed on that year. Maybe it was the next year or it had been the previous year. But that's another way that you can use that, even if it doesn't list your specific research subject.
That's so great. These schedules are so good for providing context, I think.
I was looking at the 1850 mortality schedule for Alabama this week, and it's a census that I've looked at multiple times because there's a man there who died in 1849. Named Nick Welch, N-I-C-H, so I'm pretty sure it was short for Nicholas. And there are several Welch families that lived in Pickens County, Alabama at that time, and I haven't really been able to figure out which family he belonged to, but the one clue that I have is that it says that Nick Welch died at age 26 or something, and he was born in Georgia. So looking at all the different families in that county and where they were born, I've found that there's one family that has some of the people born in Georgia. So I think he probably belongs with them. Although what I really wanted it to be was that he was the spouse of this woman named Nancy Welch, and she was apparently widowed. She was the head of household with some little children. And so I thought that maybe this is the father, but you know, it's hard to fit the pieces together when you don't have very much. So still trying to work on that puzzle, but it is really helpful that it says on the mortality schedule, the state of the person's birth.
That is such a fun example of ways to use this in your research and correlate. I love that.
I just wish that the mortality schedule included everyone who died every year.
That would be really nice.
Instead of just the year right before the census. And I'll have to do a little research because now I'm curious, like, what was the purpose of this? You know, was the federal government just curious about why people were dying, kind of like what Diana said? Or was there some other reason that they only cared about that one year? And I guess it's probably just kind of getting a snapshot of what was going on in the country, just like they did with the agricultural census, just understanding trends from one census to the next.
Yeah, I don't know the answer to that. But one other thought I had was maybe the amount of money that was being given for tax. You know, there's different tax reasons, and maybe they wanted to count the actual number of people that had been there during the year and not just the people who were living. I don't know. There's lots of different things they might have wanted to know.
That's a good point. You know, how many people were there, but some of them died. So we need to know, you know, who died and who is still living. All right. So the next schedule we're going to talk about is the social statistics schedules. Can you tell us about those?
Yeah, I love the social statistics schedules. I've used them quite a lot recently. They're kind of like the manufacturing schedules. They just give us a better picture of the communities that our ancestors lived in. And they are available for 1850 through 1880. And they give details like the valuation of real and personal estates. So that's just a total for the enumeration district. It's a valuation of the real and personal estates and the amount paid in taxes. And the interesting parts come with lists of colleges and academies and schools and libraries and how many newspapers and how many different church denominations and what kinds of seasons and crops there are and so many different details, even pauperism, crime, wages. So it gives us a great picture of what the community was like during those years. I think one thing I've really used them a lot for is to discover what churches were in a particular location so that I can locate church records. Church records are pretty important in especially like Pennsylvania. Some of those eastern states have a lot of really good church records. So it's really valuable to be able to narrow down which denominations existed. The ones I've seen haven't given names of churches, but it just tells the denominations and the number of congregations for each denomination in an area. But that's a great clue for you to be able to start looking for church records. I also used the social statistics schedule when I was doing my fourth generation project. A couple of the sons of one of my ancestors was living in this town I had never heard of called Mississinewa, Pennsylvania. And I've never heard of this town before. So I started researching and learned that Mississinewa was only in existence for just a few years, right around 1850. And the 1850 social statistics schedule showed that there was an academy there with 20 pupils. And these two brothers were listed as students on the census. And so it helped me to put together that maybe they were living in Mississinewa with who I think was a cousin or aunt or somebody while they attended that academy. So it's really helpful just to see what types of things were in your community and be able to get clues to help further your research.
What an interesting name, and also interesting that the town disappeared after a while. Great sleuthing, figuring out that there was an academy there. That's a great resource for finding out what churches, like you said, and schools and things were available. And I love the idea of looking for the newspapers in that area too on the social statistics schedule. Sometimes I wonder what newspapers were actually read in this area or produced in this town. There's a lot of listings of newspapers for a region, but then you don't really know exactly where it came from, if it covered a larger area of the state or something.
Yeah, I love the social statistics schedules.
I have just been playing here and looking at my Thomas B. Royson's County of Chambers County. I am ashamed to say I don't think I've ever used this type of non-population schedule in Chambers County, because just as you were saying, Nicole, it lists the two newspapers and they are both weekly. And the circulation, but then the churches and the religion is so interesting to see what the main religions were and how many people each will accommodate and how many churches there are and the value of the property. Wow, super interesting. I also really am fascinated with this whole idea of wages. You know, it gives the average wage and libraries. Oh, so many interesting things. Now I'm going to have to go research those for all of my ancestors and add that to their stories because it's so fascinating. We also have a schedule that's about the businesses. So what's the deal with the business schedules?
So this was just taken in 1935. It's called the 1935 Census of Business. It's basically a business directory for the whole United States, and it listed businesses in 15 different categories. Some of these schedules have been microfilmed by the National Archives, and some have been kept in paper form, but they're not available online. So if you wanted to look at these for whatever reason, then you would have to visit the National Archives. So it's just helpful to know that it's there, but it's not one that we can really access, although it's fascinating. You know, the manufacturing schedules are kind of similar, I think. So it's just a later version, maybe, of the manufacturing schedules.
And I wonder if they took that because that was the middle of the Depression. And they probably just were trying to get a good feeling for what was going on across the country with the businesses. You know, we always have to think about what was happening. What did the government want to know? Which is the real reason behind these schedules.
Yeah, they weren't created for genealogy originally, were they?
No, they were not.
Well, that brings us to the 1890 veteran schedule, which we can guess that they wanted to know how many pensions they were going to pay out.
Yeah, this isn't necessarily classified as a non-population schedule. It's classified as a special schedule, but it's a great resource, and its official name is Special Schedules of the 11th Census in 1890, enumerating Union veterans and widows of Union veterans of the Civil War. But I do think it does include some Confederate soldiers. Have either of you ever found Confederate soldiers on the 1890 schedule?
Oh, yes. In Tennessee, I have two or three that are listed, and then their names were written down, but then it's like the enumerator found out they were Confederates, and so then he didn't finish their line. It was kind of funny.
So interesting. So yeah, it can be really helpful even if you don't have Union soldier ancestors. So the information included is the veteran's rank, their company, regiment, their dates of enlistment and discharge, and the length of service. And then at the bottom of the page, it lists the post office address for each veteran or widow, and then additional details about injuries or disabilities incurred during their service. So this is really helpful. I found some of my ancestors. So my ancestor's William Beck, and he was listed on the 1890 schedule with his brother-in-law, David Hontz, and his brother, John Beck. And it gave all the information and some injuries. It was really interesting to learn, you know, just some interesting details to add. And then you can then go and find pension records and other service records based on the information on this census.
Is the 1890 veteran schedule available for all the states? Because as we know, most of the 1890 population schedules were destroyed in a fire and the water that was used to put out the fire.
Unfortunately, some of the schedules have been lost. It's only available, it's alphabetical, which is interesting. So starting with Kentucky, and then going down through the alphabet, the states are alphabetical. So anything before Kentucky in the alphabet is not available, but these are available on ancestry.com. So that's where you can find them for those states.
Great. So that veteran schedule, if you are looking for any state A through Kentucky, you won't find it, mm-hmm. but Kentucky and after you can find the veteran schedule.
Yep.
And the District of Columbia.
Well, great. We have covered so many different kinds of schedules. I think everyone listening is probably excited to go try to jump in and research these. So let's finish up this episode with talking about where to find these, what the coverage and availability of these different schedules, because they are a bit hit and miss.
Mm-hmm. They are. And it's unfortunate you get so excited about going to find these for your ancestors. And then when you learn maybe they're not available for their state, it's a bit of a disappointment. So how do you know how to find them? You can go to the National Archives webpage called Non-Population Census Records. And when you scroll down on this page, it brings you to a list of the schedules by state. And so there's little plus symbols next to every state, and you can just click that plus symbol to see what schedules are available for that state and also where they might be located. A lot of them have been digitized and they're on some of the websites. For example, Family Search has digitized a lot of non-population schedules, and some have been indexed and others haven't. Sometimes they're in locked collections and they're only available at a Family Search center. But you can look at their coverage table on the Family Search Research Wiki about non-population schedules, and that will let you know what they have for your state of interest. Ancestry also has two digitized collections for non-population schedules. The first one at Ancestry is the U.S. Selected Federal Census Non-Population Schedules from 1850 to 1880, and it includes the agriculture, industry and manufacturing, social statistics, and supplemental schedules for 21 states. So that you can search or browse. And so I like to kind of click the browse drop down arrow to just see if my state's included. And once you get to the state, it will let you see what schedules are available for your state. The mortality schedules are also available at Ancestry, and they're searchable and browsable. And that collection is just called U.S. Federal Census Mortality Schedules. So you can choose the year and state in the Browse This Collection box and see if your state and county is included before you search the database. I've done that before where sometimes I search the database and don't find anything and think, oh, I know my ancestor died. Why aren't they there? So it's good to check and just make sure that the area that your ancestor died in is even included in the database. Like we talked about, the 1890 veteran schedule is digitized at Ancestry and also at Family Search. Family Searches collection does include some miscellaneous returns for those earlier states. So if you have an ancestor that was a veteran in Alabama through Kansas, then maybe check with Family Search and see if they have those. There are not very many, but there are a few. And Family Search's collection is titled The United States Census of Union Veterans and Widows of the Civil War, 1890. Again, it has all the data for Kentucky through Wyoming. And so those are some great places to go to look for these non-population schedules.
And I would just mention, again, once you've gone to the work of figuring out what's available for your specific place, make sure you get those into your locality guide so that you don't have to do that again. You know, researching the records can be as much work as researching your ancestors, trying to figure out where to find everything. There's not really one-stop shopping for these kind of things. So that'll really help you to corral all that information and keep it safe so that the next time you're doing a research project, you know exactly what's available and you can go to work.
Yeah, that's such a great idea.
Thank you for going through all of the places where these schedules can be found online. That's great. And then some are available at the National Archives. So that's cool to think about how much we have available at our fingertips to research online that we may not have tried before.
Absolutely. I am just really fascinated with all the things we've talked about today and thinking about how we can really tell the story of our ancestors' lives better by using these schedules. So thank you, Alice. It's been really fun to talk through all these varieties of sources.
You're welcome. Thank you so much for having me. They are such great resources.
All right, everyone listening, if you haven't yet used these non-population schedules in your research, then hopefully you can think of how they might help you and benefit your research and adding details to the stories of your ancestors' lives. Have a great week, everybody, and we will talk to you again next week.
Right. Bye-bye, everyone.
Bye.
Bye-bye. Thank you for listening. We hope that something you heard today will help you make progress in your research. If you want to learn more, purchase our book, Research Like a Pro, A Genealogist's Guide, on Amazon.com and other booksellers. You can also register for our Research Like a Pro online course or join our next study group. Learn more at familylocket.com. To share your progress and ask questions, join our private Facebook group by sending us your book receipt or joining our e-course or study group. If you like what you heard and would like to support this podcast, please subscribe, rate, and review. We hope you'll start now to research like a pro.